Greetings, Avon High School ACE College Algebra 2 students, anybody else out there watching, you're going to take a look at a video here that's going to introduce the idea of the ellipse. And whether you're a student that's in Algebra 2 that's just learning about the ellipse, or in pre-calculus where you might go into a little bit more detail about the ellipse, this video can probably accommodate both groups. But we will go into the idea of the focus points, which is typically something that would not be covered until pre-calc. So what we have right here, pictured to the right, is the graph of an ellipse. It says, before we begin to study the relationship between the equation of the graph of an ellipse, it says you first might want to look at a little bit of vocabulary. So here you're going to find some statements with words that are underlined, and based on the graph, we want to see if you can come up with a definition of each of the underlined words. Obviously, we start with the center point, which is -1, 3. It's probably likely at this stage you guys have already studied circles. Circles have centers. Ellipses have centers, just the same. In fact, the formula of an ellipse will probably be in a form very similar to the center radius form of a circle, and making the center very easy to find. Now you have another pair of points, 1, 2, which is up here. I'm going to circle in blue, and the point 1, -8 down there that I've circled in blue, those are called the vertices. So if you think about what would be an active definition of the vertices, well, they would be points obviously on the ellipse. They seem to be the points on the ellipse that are farthest from one another. And I think for right now, that could suffice as a definition. The two points on the ellipse that are farthest from one another. If you want to give a little bit more insight to that definition, they would not only be those two points that are farthest from each other, but they're also two points that would lie on a line that goes through the center. Let's go ahead and take a look at this other definition. Now, depending on what kind of book you use, what teacher you have, it's likely that maybe the phrase or the word co-vertex or co-vertices aren't used. I like this because otherwise we really don't have a name for these other guys. The points I'm talking about are -1, -3, and 3, -3. We are going to call those co-vertices. Now, if we had to come up with a working definition for those two, I would be careful to say that they are the two points on the ellipse that are closest to each other, because that's a terrible definition. Because I could pick any random two points on the ellipse, like those two guys, and say, well, heck, those are two points pretty close to each other. So we have to still use the idea that they all lie on a line that goes through the center. So if you think about the two points that lie closest to one another on the ellipse that are also on a line that passes through the center, and that'll work temporarily as a working definition for the co-vertices, right? But think about the vertices as being the longer distance traveled and the co-vertices as the shorter distance traveled. Okay, what other kinds of things? Well, we have this idea about the length of the major axis. You got the word major that seems to imply large. The major axis would be the distance between your vertices. And we can see that this distance is 10. If we were to count these squares, we can go from the top to the bottom, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. The length of the minor axis is 4. If I count from left to right, it's 4 blocks to go across. So those are some interesting aspects about the ellipse, aspects that you would probably study in an Algebra 2 class. Now, when you move to the next level, we talk about some other points. And this is where things start to get interesting. It says there are two other points labeled on the graph, and you can see that they don't have very pretty values. 1, 1.583, which happens to be the one that's up here, and then 1, -7.583, which is down here. Now let's read this paragraph, and then I'll go back up to the graph and we'll talk about it. It says these two points are called the foci. Foci is a plural for the word focus. I've heard it pronounced foci. I think that's probably incorrect, but I would probably understand what a student meant if they said foci. From the information, it is a bit far-fetched to expect you to be able to define what these two are, so we're going to leave it to a little investigation. Right. If you're watching this video at a different school, you may have seen a teacher do something kind of interesting with a piece of string. I'm going to be doing that with my class in a few days. But there's a lot of neat ways that you can define these foci points. So it says, measure the distance from the top focus to one of the co-vertices. It says this distance should be the same as what other distance. So let's return to this picture, and I've done a pretty good job of messing this picture up, so I am going to erase everything, start with a clean slate, and we are going to actually find the distance from one foci to the next. So I'm going to see if I can kind of put together a little tool here that will let me draw a line, and that red line is what I'm trying to compute. Okay? Now, I would not wish this upon my worst enemy, to find the distance of this red line between those two endpoints, because look at that coordinate, 1.583. That would just be terrible. So we're going to use a calculator. So I'm going to run over to my graphing calculator. I'm going to kind of clean it up here a little bit. And I'm going to use the distance formula, which says take the square root of the difference between the x coordinates. It does not matter which order we enter them. I'll take the top point, which if you recall was 1, 1.583, and I'm taking its x coordinate only, and then I'll take the x coordinate of the other point, which was -1, -3, and I'm going to go back to the graph just to verify that, taking 1 - -1. Now I'm going to take for my y coordinates, I'm going to subtract those and square them. So I remember what they are. Don't forget, I need to square things, so square that. And then I will add the difference between 1.583. Let's double check. 1.583. And then I'll subtract -3. And then I must square him as well. That's my distance formula. I'll hit enter, and that is the distance between those two points. It's almost 5, but you know, just not quite. 5.00039. Now let's go back down here and read what the rest of the question says. It says, this distance should be the same as what other distance? So if we go back up to this ellipse and we start thinking about where would there possibly be another segment that has that same distance? Well, it turns out that there are actually 3 segments that have that same exact distance. And one way that I might be able to demonstrate this is by taking that segment that I just drew in, and I could possibly clone it. And I could clone it again, and maybe a fourth time. I'm going to move a couple of them out of the way and then let you guys sort of think, where could I put this segment that would have the same length? And if I do that, I find that I could place it right here. If I do the same thing for these other segments, I might have to move them around a little bit, and lo and behold, I could find those located in a very similar situation where I have the same length. So if we continue looking at these relationships, we're asked, based on the picture we've drawn, what relationship would be true about this right triangle? It's based on the Pythagorean theorem. Well, the Pythagorean theorem that we see here is certainly going to be one that involves this right triangle. I'm going to use dashed lines here if I could, on across. So it goes without saying that we could say that the sum of the squares of the two blue dashed sides would equal the square of the right side. And that's certainly true. In fact, I could even demonstrate that with the TI Inspire. So I can pull this up, and maybe I can even make this just a little bit smaller so that you can see both it and picture. So I'm going to go ahead and enter that in. So I'm going to say, all right, I've got this distance across, which is a distance of 2. So I know that 2 squared, buttons are awfully small. Let's see if I can make this a little bit bigger. And then I will add to that the distance along this segment. Now this one's a little trickier because you have the 1.583 distance above the x-axis, but then there's this additional distance of 3 to get to the center. So that would make a total of 4.583. And I will square it. And if I add that together, of course, I get this result that I can then take the square root of, and I end up with, hey, guess what? Something very, 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 very close. Now, the one thing that's a little tricky about this, 5.00039 number that you're seeing is heavily approximated. And it's approximated because this value that I've given you, 1.583, has been approximated. So I want to declare for right now, and then it'll be more clear in another video, that this distance is pretty darn close to 5, and I would like to declare it to be 5 instead of 5.00039. Now, do we recognize another distance in this problem that was equivalent to 5? Well, you may recall the entire length of that segment was 5, the one that goes all the way up to the vertex. So when we're asked to answer this question here, based on the picture, what relationship must be true about the right triangle? What we will say is that the distance, let's get this straight, the distance from the center to a co-vertex squared plus the distance from the center to the focus point. Well, I'm sorry, let me take that back. We've got the distance from the center to the vertex, co-vertex squared, and we're going to add that to this blue line, which is the distance from the center to the focus. I'll use a different color for that. The distance from the center to the focus, or one of our foci, probably should have called it focus point, but this will make sense. We know that that would be equal to this diagonal distance, which is kind of meaningless to us right now. But we do know that this diagonal distance, remember, that is the quantity that was produced right here in this top line of the calculator, 5.00039, that we're going to declare to be 5. Well, that's the same as the entire distance from the center to the vertex. And that's what we're going to use for the other side of this equation. The distance from the center to a vertex squared. And it's going to be this relationship that you see down here that's going to enable you to find the points that are called foci points of any of your ellipses. Now in the next video, I'll go into a little bit more detail with my example 1, where we find all of these various components, including the foci. So I would encourage you to watch that. Thanks for watching, I'll see you next time.